Will the petrodollar collapse in 2018? Will the petrodollar collapse in 2018? The oil industry and geopolitical risks have gone hand in hand. Oil represents energy, and without it, modern economies cannot run. Salt, sugar, and spices were also strategic resources once. But even at the peak of their appeal and value, they are mere shadows of oil's importance to the modern world. Yet changes in the oil industry and the erosion of America's dominance over geopolitics have also hurt the US dollar, which has long served as the one currency that all countries must have to buy oil. The concept has become known as the petrodollar, and a petrodollar collapse in 2018 is possible, if not likely. Oil demand has been increasing slowly since the 2008 financial crisis. However, the United States, once the principal driver of the oil industry, will no longer be the primary source of demand. The new emerging economic powers like China and India will soon be dictating the terms of the price of oil. The pairing between the size of the American economy and its world-leading oil appetite is what allowed the petrodollar system to emerge. Thus, any change to one or both variables could spell the collapse of the petrodollar system. Why should you or anyone else care about the petrodollar? The petrodollar is one of the main reasons why America itself can survive on debt. It's the main reason why, unlike many countries in the European Union, for example in times of turmoil, the Federal Reserve can apply monetary policies to help prevent or mask economic or financial collapse. In the 1970s, when oil prices reached their longest peaks, inflation adjusted, the producing countries reinvested the billions of dollars they received as payment into the global economy. This drove the demand for dollars, sustaining their value. In other words, global oil demand turned the dollar into the world's de facto reserve currency. The US economy could collapse trying to cope with the effects of a petrodollar collapse. Oil exporters agreed with the US that the returns on their use would be held in dollars. Indeed, the creation of the petrodollar in 1973 coincided with the US depegging the value of the dollar from gold prices to allow for fiat money. The oil producers were told they would earn returns on their dollars equivalent to those they would have earned investing in gold. The end of the petrodollar is bad news for US military. Surely, countries are free to accumulate reserves of other stable currencies from the British pound or the euro. But why would they? They need dollars to buy the most critical resource, oil. It's the oil plus dollar system that enables the United States to invest in terribly expensive weapon systems, fund the world's biggest and most spread out military, and conduct military operations whose costs alone would cripple anyone else. Demand for oil equals demand for dollars. Thus, if some countries suddenly demand to pay for the oil they need in another reserve currency, it poses a major risk to the United States. China might be one of the primary culprits in facilitating the petrodollar breakdown. It could replace the petrodollar with a petroyuan. This is hardly far-fetched. The United States doesn't need Middle Eastern oil as much as it did 30-40 years ago. Still, many countries still do. China, for example, imports a significant percentage of its oil from Iran. As a result, there's a natural shift in demand for a currency that best suits those countries. China has proposed the yuan could replace the dollar in oil transactions. It would find strong agreement in Iran, Russia, and Venezuela, which account for a large share of the oil market. The crunch is that the Chinese have also asked the Saudis to consider accepting yuan for oil. That move could even spell the end of the special military supply relationship between Washington and Riyadh. Even if the Saudis may not feel that now is the right time to switch horses in the oil/currency wars, they might consider diversifying the way they sell their debt. It's a given that when Saudi Arabia or other Gulf states issue all their bonds in dollars, they could move to yuan. Is the next recession coming in 2019 or 2020? Next recession 2019. Some analysts fear the next recession in 2019. Others warn it may have already begun and that the year for the next recession is 2018. They are both right because the economy and the markets whose performance can trigger a downturn are operating in a parallel universe now. Whether it's 2019 or 2018, it seems appropriate to start asking, when will the next recession be? The Federal Reserve lacks a plan and it will switch to new management in 2018. Janet Yellen is out and Jerome Powell is in. But judging by the rumors, all of the people who will help him evaluate the best rate policy are already in disagreement. Some say there should be 3 rate hikes. Others fear that even 2 hikes might be too many. 3 rate hikes could interfere with plans to boost inflation to about 2%. Certainly, it could slow economic growth. Meanwhile, the interest rate policy has to confront the effects of the aggressive tax reform. Its intention is to stimulate investment and employment. But it also makes paying down the federal debt more difficult. Until recently, the US dollar and its dominance of all transactions involving commodities from oil to gold have worked because of unchallenged US economic and military might. Now, both those things are under threat. What will cause the next recession? Predicting the next recession with precision is always hard, if not impossible. But it's even harder to pinpoint the specific cause or causes. Only in retrospect can such a complex process as a recession be taken apart and understood. Then, there's the fact that no recession begins the same way or under the same circumstances. For example, by any measure, most indications suggest that Donald Trump's first year in office would have been marked by some form of economic or financial malaise. Gold prices, after all, were going up and stocks seemed headed for a correction on November 9, 2016, the day after the 2016 presidential election. Nevertheless, perhaps unlike other recessions, there are abundant signs and hints that something isn't quite what it seems. That something is wrong with the health of the US economy. The rules of economics flaunting valuations on Wall Street have created the illusion of widespread prosperity. And that's the key to guessing when the next recession is coming. Simply, the tax reform has exacerbated the distortion in equity prices. They haven't risen because of any organic growth, that is, from actual revenues or profits per share. They've risen on the expectation of profits and the fact that lower taxes will boost profits without companies necessarily having sold more widgets. So far, so good. Until interest rates start moving higher, essentially offsetting the effects of the tax cuts. If borrowing costs more, even the fiscal incentives that Trump has fought to get through Congress won't work as intended. Uncharted financial territory. The United States is literally entering uncharted financial territory. Rather than help the middle and lower classes put more money in their bank accounts, fueling the economy with more spending across the board, the tax cuts have added leverage mostly to stock prices. Meanwhile, they risk pushing federal budget deficits to about $1 trillion. Apart from making government shutdowns into annual events over the next few years, they fly in the face of standard practice. Now, there's a situation where interest rates are still low, but taxes are relatively lower, with plans for the government to spend to improve infrastructure. Nonetheless, it's when the economy slows down that interest rates are low and taxes are cut. The recipe for higher valuations in the stock market and higher interest rates contributes to a recession. Perhaps the recession is not an immediate one. But it could arrive by 2019 or 2020. Certainly, all the ingredients are in the cauldron and boiling. The problem is that with the low interest rates, the resulting outflow of liquidity is the reason stocks keep moving higher. So far, the interest rate hikes have not done any damage. On the contrary, the fact that the 4 interest rate hikes so far that have pushed it to 1.5% after almost a decade at near zero has enhanced market performance the same way that anabolic steroids do for athletes. Investors are too confident. They have become used to picking stocks as if they were playing darts. No matter where they land on the board, they score points. Jerome Powell, another Yellen. The US Senate has approved Jerome Powell's nomination to head the Federal Reserve. This allows Trump to have his cake and eat it too. After all, what's the point of having a cake? Trump got to choose his own Fed chair. He did so, taking care not to appoint a replacement who might tamper with Yellen's gradual approach to rates. Trump is not shaking the boat. Clearly, he sees his legacy as one tied to stock market performance. But that's not necessarily a good thing for the economy. Or the markets. Economy predictions for 2020, or earlier, have become uncertain at best and dire at worst. The Federal Reserve has released such an overflow of liquidity that nobody knows how equities will react in the face of the nominal rate moving to over 2% in 2018 in accordance with the course set by Yellen, and 3% in 2019. In addition, the purpose of embarking on a course to gradually tighten the monetary supply when Yellen started to raise rates in 2015 was to avert inflation. But inflation has not come. It has not moved by much. People aren't spending their cash. Either there's too little of it, given few Americans have any to speak of, or they're holding on to it because they have a pessimistic sentiment about the economy. One of the nominees for a Federal Reserve seat, Marvin Goodfriend, even suggests the possibility of applying negative interest rates. This, he says, might prompt people to spend their money and fuel the inflation so many fear, even if it's not there. Inflation is not rising fast enough. In other words, for inflation to rise and justify the rate hikes, there needs to be actual economic growth. The kind that comes in a tide that lifts all boats. So far, there appears to be faith that this might happen thanks to the tax cuts, but no evidence. The other problem about higher rates is that there's always the risk that it may prompt investors to sell their shares. After all, the cash they earn can be put in a bank account and start to accumulate interest. Cash, in an uncertain situation like the one higher Fed rates are creating, helps many investors deal with fear. The fear is valid. Wall Street is overvalued. The risk of an accident, or, to use a more current term, a black swan, has become extremely high. Anything could burst the bubble now. Looking at a chart of stock market performance from the last century to the present, it becomes evident that the markets have already entered a stage that finds its closest precedent in the 1990s and the dreaded October 1929 crash. Note that the latter crash was merely the earthquake that prompted the start of the equity avalanche. It would only be in 1933 that the lowest values were achieved. Note the similarity in the way the index rose between 1923 to 1929 and 2009 to 2018. Then note the sharpness of the jagged descent from 1929 to 1933. Investors act as if drunk. They are riding the wave of euphoria and have forgotten what it's like when they lose. The market corrections have been minor and brief. Nobody has had the opportunity to burn their fingers, and many investors have never known what it's like to confront a bear market or the kinds of interest rates that were once considered normal. As recently as the early 2000s, rates were in the order of 7-9%. That would be positively catastrophic today. The Trump tax plan is a convenient way to mask deeper problems in the American economy. The cuts didn't just materialize from thin air. The government will have to find the funds to keep the many services that Americans need, including very rich Americans. Evidently, medical services will suffer. The much-lauded infrastructure schemes may start. But there's a risk the government will run out. Borrowing, meanwhile, will become more expensive, adding billions to the interest payments on the federal debt alone. Individual families, meanwhile, will face higher interest on mortgages and loans. Oh, by the way, it was higher interest rates that caused the real estate bubble to explode in 2007 to 2008. Rather, Trump should have pushed for tax cuts. But the bulk of the benefits would have been better invested in the middle and lower classes. That would truly have increased spending. It would also have helped debt repayment, reducing risk. Instead, for most people, the tax breaks are almost insignificant and they're not guaranteed to last. Perhaps, had Trump persisted in conducting an isolationist foreign policy, he could have made some concessions by cutting military spending. But this too is different. There are risks of wars in Asia and the Middle East, and Trump seems ready to go in with both feet. Will the petrodollar collapse in 2018? Will the petrodollar collapse in 2018? The oil industry and geopolitical risks have gone hand in hand. Oil represents energy, and without it, modern economies cannot run. Salt, sugar, and spices were also strategic resources once. But even at the peak of their appeal and value, they are mere shadows of oil's importance to the modern world. Yet changes in the oil industry and the erosion of America's dominance over geopolitics have also hurt the US dollar, which has long served as the one currency that all countries must have to buy oil. The concept has become known in many countries in the European Union. For example, in times of turmoil, the Federal Reserve can apply monetary policies to help prevent a mass economic or financial collapse. In the 1970s, when oil prices reached their longest peaks, inflation adjusted, the producing countries reinvested the billions of dollars they received as payment into the global economy. This drove the demand for dollars, sustaining their value. In other words, global oil demand turned the dollar into the world's de facto reserve currency. The US economy could collapse trying to cope with the effects of a petrodollar collapse. Oil exporters agreed with the US that the returns on their use would be held in dollars. Indeed, the creation of the petrodollar in 1973 coincided with the US depegging the value of the dollar from gold prices to allow for fiat money. The oil producers were told they would earn returns on their dollars equivalent to those they would have earned investing in gold. The end of the petrodollar is bad news for US military. Surely, countries are free to accumulate reserves of other stable currencies from the British pound or the euro. But why would they? They need dollars to buy the most critical resource, oil. It's the oil plus dollar system that enables the United States to invest in terribly expensive weapon systems, fund the world's biggest and most spread out military, and conduct military operations whose costs alone would cripple anyone else. Demand for oil equals demand for dollars. Thus, if some countries suddenly demand to pay for the oil they need in another reserve currency, it poses a major risk to the United States. China might be one of the primary culprits in facilitating the petrodollar breakdown. It could replace the petrodollar with a petroyuan. This is hardly far-fetched. The United States doesn't need Middle Eastern oil as much as it did 30-40 years ago. Still, many countries still do. China, for example, imports a significant percentage of its oil from Iran. As a result, there's a natural shift in demand for a currency that best suits those countries. China has proposed the yuan could replace the dollar in oil transactions. It would find strong agreement in Iran, Russia, and Venezuela, which account for a large share of the oil market. The crunch is that the Chinese have also asked the Saudis to consider accepting yuan for oil. Known as the petrodollar, and a petrodollar collapse in 2018 is possible, if not likely. Oil demand has been increasing slowly since the 2008 financial crisis. However, the United States, once the principal driver of the oil industry, will no longer be the primary source of demand. The new emerging economic powers like China and India will soon be dictating the terms of the price of oil. The pairing between the size of the American economy and its world-leading oil appetite is what allowed the petrodollar system to emerge. Thus, any change to one or both variables could spell the collapse of the petrodollar system. Why should you or anyone else care about the petrodollar? The petrodollar is one of the main reasons why America itself can survive on debt. It's the main reason why, unlike many